All right, Dr. McCollum, thank you very much. Last lecture is going to be Dr. Gross, and he's going to be talking about that patient presenting with their first seizure.
My first.
Is this on?
So I have to flip the switch on the side.
That this.
Cool. Okay. Is that too loud? Okay. It just sounds really loud. So I'm the last thing to make sure you guys at lunch. Something I have a place to be. I'm not here by choice.
That's quite a fuck up what McCollum said.
And I thought this was going to be a really great lecture to follow, but it won't have to be a tough act to follow. So seizure care without neurology being present. And I'm actually not talking about just the first time seizure, we'll talk a little more stuff. So I do need to add a warning that I'm not going to talk about pediatric patients at all, but I figured that would really grab your attention. So only adults that we can talk about. It's kind of nice to know what our terminology actually means, because we use the words sometimes without knowing what they mean or where they come from. So seizure, two diseases, the sudden attack of the illness. And it comes from the Greek seismos or CN. I did not double check because I'm trying to let it miss anything on the center of that. But seismos is the shaking that goes along with that. So seizure. Epilepsy. Again, to lay, like to hold upon, or to grasp, or seize upon, or to a military kind of stuff. So something is gradually attacked you, in this case, throwing you to the ground, to take hold of, or to grasp. So it was also interesting, the Old English was the falling sickness, which is straight out of German, which is Fallsucht, which is the seeking of falling. And some folks in some sickle episodes, they thought it was seizure episodes because they're falling. It's like, no, that's not quite the same thing. But, and then ictus, we use that word quite a bit, post-ictal state. What is actually ictus? It is that rhythmic, metrical stress, like someone pounding something, hammering. And in this case, it's also used for voices for the rhythm of the meter that's there. In this case, applied over to the seizure. So that's actually the ictus.
Okay, well, enough of that stuff. Most of you guys may not be interested in
etymology, but I find it fun. So we're going to talk about these things here, so the definitions. I figured it was worthwhile to go over the ASAP policy because
policies are there to protect you, but by the same token, if you're not following policies, then you're putting yourself at risk. And be honest, how many of you guys, when there's a policy that comes out, actually read the policy from beginning to end?
Yeah, me neither.
Okay, so it's kind of nice to know what a lawyer's going to try and give you on, because that is what you're being held to. Okay, so those are the policymakers, they're going to protect us. But when you're deviating, there's never a good reason for it not to do that. Workup for the seizure treatment, and then of course the bad actor that no one wants to ever see is the status epilepticus because, oh my gosh, it's just terrible. And that's the final order of discharge instructions. So, AKA,
here's the other version of the outline.
What do I need to do to diagnose this correctly? What rules do I need to know about? What blood tests? What do I need to order? Blood tests, x-rays. Who needs a scan? What medications do I need to give? What's more like adjusting doses when we manage that?
Yeah. Oh crap. Status epilepticus.
Now what? All right, just to level the playing field, and this maybe hopefully is a little bit reassuring.
So there are lots of patients that are out there with seizures. 3% of the population has seizure disorder. There's each of us here in the room, unless you already have a seizure disorder, you have 11% risk of having a seizure episode during your lifetime. Does that make you a seizure patient, or mean that you have epilepsy? No, it doesn't mean that. Maybe you had a hypoxic episode and passed out and had a few beads of clonus to go along with that.
Kind of seizure if you're having.
Doesn't mean that you can have stuff for the rest of your life.
Lots of visits to the ER, I don't know if that's any surprise to you. This next one's interesting. 20-25% of folks initially diagnosed with a seizure are misdiagnosed. We're going to get it wrong, by 25% of the time. But it comes to neurology, and you do have the luxury of getting a consultant. It's not always right. Recurrence rate, this one's kind of important. It's less than 42% chance over 2 years, which is why the first time seizure does not automatically get medication. Probably don't need it. Okay. More than half of them are not going to have a seizure episode in the next
2 years. And most of them actually do have one, but they're going to have it in the next 6 months. Which kind of goes along with the structure of the driving system, which we're going to touch on at the end. Less than half are going to be seizure-free with a single anti-epileptic drug. That's what AED is going to be here in my different litter. And 30% of them, and those are the 30% we typically see, are never going to have complete seizure control. They're going to keep coming to the ER with seizure episodes. Okay, so, which slide is this one? All right, definition of seizure itself. So, just one episode of seizing does not mean that you have a seizure diagnosis, and that you had an event. It's not until you have two or more episodes that you decide, okay, this person actually has epilepsy. It has to be an unprovoked seizure. Getting whacked in the head with a crowbar and you seize as a result of that, that's a provoked seizure. Being hypomanic, you seize, that's a provoked seizure. Okay, it's not idiopathic epilepsy. Most of them resolve in very short order. We know that most of the time they quit, they're debated. Sometimes they'll have another episode while they're in the ER. If they're, and certainly most of them are done by 5 minutes, but most of them a lot just a few seconds in under the battery. And because the suppressive mechanism of the seizure, those receptors get taken up very quickly, the longer the seizure lasts, the less likely it is to resolve on its own. So by the time you get 5 minutes, you should be thinking instead of epileptic.
Okay?
Yeah.
It's here, it's fine.
So, if the patient is very seizing 5 minutes, you need to be thinking, you need to be changing gears here, so that's epilepticus, rather than going by the old traditional definition, which is, you know, if the seizure has been going for 30 minutes, at 30 minutes, you are in a deep crap. Your patient's in deep crap. And you're going to have a very difficult time. You should be jumping on this at 5 minutes already, preparing, because that seizure should have stopped. Okay? The other part of that status epilepticus definition is the patient who has an episode and does not return to their baseline neurologic status before having another episode. Okay? So, and then this last bullet here is particularly important. If the seizure seems to stop, but your patient's not waking up, there's a very good chance that they're still seizing. Okay? And they've moved on to a non-convulsive state. And you have to look very careful. There may be some little subtle twitching of one of the mouth, and they will flicker the eye. Isn't quite right, or maybe some just fingers, something that's there. That should, it's like, this guy's still seizing. Because we don't have the luxury of just, I'll just get out the EEG, my little pocket EEG, I'm sure there's an app for it. Strap it on, and that patient's still seizing. Maybe one day, but right now there's not. Although I have seen at one of the ASAP conferences, there's a little Velcro band thing that just kind of sits on the scalp, it's supposed to be disposable. We'll see how that pans out. But right now, that's not available to any of us. Okay, now, definitions. Does anybody here in the room seem like they have a little difficulty with some of these definitions of trying to classify these things? This is the partial, simple, complex, retrograde. Okay, I'm going to show you several slides where folks keep taking stabs at defining these things. Some are from ASAP, some are from the problem neurology. Okay, and each person has a different way of organizing this stuff. So when you're sitting there, like, this is confusing. It's because it is confusing because nobody does it the same way. So primary, secondary, so primary, secondary function, there are young folks that have seizure disorder. Well, okay. And pretty much everything after that is being triggered by something else.
Yeah,
it's typically some kind of structural thing, either adaptive, either from an internal kind of process, the patient with the severe hypertension, or eclampsia, or alcohol withdrawal, or some outright exogenous trigger, like a toxic dose of something, or the street drug that they're using. So that's one way to move. Another, this is from the ASAP guidelines. This talks about the provoked versus the unprovoked seizure again. Lumped a little differently, and you can read this stuff later on your own. It's moving along. And then there's the generalized versus the partial seizures or non-convulsive stuff. So some folks will, under the generalized, lump together the full-blown grand mal seizure that's shaking all over, as well as the absence seizure, because you have loss of consciousness with that. So that kind of makes it that generalized seizure, as opposed to the partial seizures, where
You think you're totally full of crap? You're just sitting there. I'm having a seizure right now.
Right.
You can't say, bullshit. Okay. But that may be the partial seizure, which may go on to the Jacksonia, the more generalized thing where they continue recruiting more stuff and they find out the generalized seizure. But it starts out as a partial, which becomes more generalized. Still left as a focal seizure.
Okay.
Partial seizure. So it's simple, but there's no loss of consciousness, but a complex where they proceed to generalize and lose the level of consciousness.
Yet another way of doing it.
Yeah, the generalized tree comes up here, the tonic-clonic, the axons, and then the myoclonic and atonic, versus over there the focal or partial seizures,
whether they become generalized or not. Is it confusing? Yeah, it's confusing.
When you do this, just describe it as interesting. Even nobody cares. You've labeled it this way, you've labeled it that way. Seizure is not a seizure. Do you make the guess for us? We're going to get it wrong 25% of the time. Is it something else? We'll talk about something in a minute. And one more reference here from Tint and Alley. Get some more modification stuff here. Generalized and axons are separate categories, even levels. Okay,
everyone's doing a little different.
Okay, so, patient comes in. What's the neurologist do? They do lots of stuff. Okay. Does anyone here that works as a neurologist available? Can you talk to them and like, well, did you get the calcium, the magnesium, the phosphorus level, and did you get the urine drug screen and all that stuff?
Yeah, okay.
We'll talk about what it is that you least required to do. But you can look down these bullets. Thorough history. This is the stuff that you learn in medical school if you keep wanting to put out. Complete history, good physical examination. Look for those things. Ask, is there anything else that you've been taking, anything else that you've been doing, what's been changed? You have a long-standing seizure history. Have you been taking medication? Did you take it the way you're supposed to take it? It's two different questions, right? Have you been taking it, or are you taking it the way you're supposed to take it? I don't know about you guys, but I'm standing here to admit to you that where I work, we have patients that are, they're non-compliant. They don't follow their instructions. They don't follow the labeling. Yeah. And some more, they're all looking at their labels like, are mezzanine and cocaine. Silly question. Okay. Physical examination. Lots of imaging stuff that they'll resort to, which may not be immediately available. You may not need, we'll get to that in a second. And we'll learn lots and lots of blood tests. Lots and lots of blood tests. Okay, so how do we like to approach it? Usual standard stuff, ABCs, monitor oxygen, depending on what's going on. As appropriate, you may get extensive testing. As appropriate, you may do the imaging.
Is our patient still seizing? Are they still altered? What's going on?
Don't forget tonic paralysis. That's sometimes very concerning. I do telemedicine consults. So I got a consult just about 3 weeks ago about a gentleman who was postictal. He came in actively seizing. He's a young man, maybe 35, something like that. His history was that he'd fallen a week earlier, presented altered at the same hospital, was found to have a subdural hematoma, was transferred to another facility where they ended up opening him up, draining the subdural hematoma. He was fine, they discharged him home. He'd been home less than 24 hours and now had a seizure.
Okay, probable seizure, good, generalized seizure, who's
still unresponsive. The physician appropriately
gave him anti-epileptic medications. He decided to use Keppra. We loaded him up by the book. And now this person wasn't waking up properly, and he's like, history of subdural hematoma, and I've been transferred, and all kinds of stuff. And the person was just still just, you know, it was just depressed, minimally arousable, but somewhat arousable. No much nerves, just sitting tight and waiting and watching a little bit. By the time I was done with the consult, I actually started to wake up with the calls of school commands and started to verbalize a little bit. But you want to transfer this back before the process changed. We observed, like I said, I'll just sit tight a little bit. Later on, you're still stuck. I'm happy to accept it, but I think right now, transferring across the state is not as best interest. This is essentially like a teeny tiny ER, it's a pretty good sized ER, so we have plenty of resources to sit tight and watch.
and you guys are there by yourselves in your very small bed, you may need to get them out.
Fine.
Okay. It's going to be a resource dependent. Sometimes it's also like, okay, nobody else in the ER right now, I can sit back and watch this. Maybe just like you're drunk and you can sit there and metabolize until we could be free to move along. Breakfast club. So, as a program. Okay, well,
what are our guidelines say? So the 2014 guidelines actually simply say
the subject of what testing, what lab tests and x-rays to do, we've already previously discussed in our old policy, and we're not changing that. So I've done that a little bit and found the old policy, 2004. So the question is, because that's how these policies are written, specific questions being asked and looking at the answers. So red slides are going to be the questions, yellow slides are going to be the answers. What laboratory tests indicate an otherwise healthy adult patient with new onset seizure who is returned back to his baseline and neurologic status? Not a whole lot. There's no level A or level C recommendations, level B is basically, this is kind of the general consensus of what we do. So, this is a big thing, no hormone comorbidities, we can't be sick of us. Healthy person with all seven tests. Check blood sugar, check sodium.
Women get a pregnancy test. Okay.
And if they're immunocompromised, they're doing bigger work with lumbar puncture. Okay, there's no magnesium, there's no calcium, there's no phosphorus, there's no CDCE. Okay, that's it.
That's kind of the minimum that you need to order. So it's not just, you can't just blow them off. You gotta do a little bit of stuff.
But you don't have to do this like gigantic mega work
on otherwise healthy individuals.
Okay. Now if there's something else in history that tips you off, it's like, so it's just,
then by all means, keep ordering stuff.
Okay. Something in the physical exam is just, you know, outside of the seizure, it's more focal, it's not just generalized. Maybe there's a structural issue that you need to go looking more further. Okay. So, for the imaging, the old stuff was, well, here are specific reasons to pain scans. This patient has pain status, epileptics, or back front. If there's abnormal neurological findings, fine.
So they're not referring to their baseline.
GCS of 15, fine. Prolonged headache history, it's gotten a little awful. History of malignancy, close hip injury, HIV, anticoagulant use,
a little bit older patient. Then those are all indications for getting the scan. But
does that help us? You kind of like to image everybody? Well, that was raised as well in 2004 stuff.
And basically came down to, and this person who's otherwise normal and is back to their baseline,
then
you have the option of deferring that imaging study to a later date, provided you get some kind of, it's done reasonably timely.
Okay, and it's sure that it's gonna happen. Now, if your facility is kind of like mine, granted I'm bigger, but I can't rely on anything once folks step outside the door, and I certainly can't rely on my clinic system either, because they'll call and say, oh, well, you have a lot of insurance, so even though that you're supposed to get that study done, we're gonna deny you that access, or we're not going to get you a clinical appointment because you don't have the insurance, or whatever. Then we should do the ER slide. It's going to be done in 10 minutes. I'll have the answer that I want finished. It's much better than walking around and worrying about someone slipping through the cracks. But you may have a number of small community hospitals that actually have very good systems in place to take care of folks there in the community, and you can do the expedited workup as an outpatient. Obviously, you'll make a phone call to the neurologist or hospitalist, the person or primary care doctor who's going to finish following that through the referrals as needed. So your risk of not time, you do not have to get scanned. If scan is not available, you have all that stuff. Sometimes scans go down. You have the option of delaying it. It is okay. Yes?
You are going to scan outside trauma, do you contrast all of
them?
Outside trauma, if you're going to scan them, you contrast
them. No. If there's a question about something, or there's history of maybe a focality or something, which would be another reason for the scan in the first place, if we're going to move on to an MRI. So I want to keep blasting away the radiation, but I need to limit the number of tests, because it's, one physician taught me a long time ago when I was still a resident, if you imagine just before we ordering the concept, if you imagine the order sheet, what's not seen here, but if you remember the old order sheet, every time you put it on order, imagine the patient's signed stack of blank checks, and every time you order a test, you're making a withdrawal from the banking account. And how much do you feel like you need to breathe down your banking account
know who you're ordering it for. Are you ordering for the patient? Are you ordering for the family? Are you ordering it for yourself as a sleeper? Are you treating the chart? Are you treating the lawyer? Know who you're treating, know who you're ordering tests for. Okay. As long as you know that, rather than just reflexively ordering a bunch of crap, then it's okay. Okay, so moving up to 2014. Question here is, exclusion. So basically, this does not apply to kids, said earlier, adults only. And as soon as there's suspicion that there's something else structural significant or something concerning medical history, then it doesn't apply. So, first seizure. Do we need to initiate anti-epileptic drugs in the ER?
No.
You know, organization says that. We need not initiate AEDs in the ED for patients who've had first unprovoked. To provoke or unprovoked seizure. Unless there's something else that you do need. If there is additional important needed, because for the provoked seizure, additional stuff needs to be investigated. Something else is going on. So hopefully you've uncovered that. And then a lot of times just taking care of the problem. For example, we had that sudden this morning of 150 in real, then getting that addressed and getting that turned down, that's definitive treatment for that seizure, not starting them on Dilantin.
Okay.
This also includes folks who have a remote history of traumatic brain injury. It has to be past 7 days, that's kind of where that threshold is. And it becomes, goes from acute to remote. Okay, patients who have returned to their baseline status again normal, do they need to be admitted to the hospital? EPs need not admit, emergency physicians need not admit patients with the first unprovoked seizure who have returned to their clinical baseline. I'm sorry, when I read that, it just kind of reminded me, this is just very convoluted English, reminds me of the lines from the Pirates of the Caribbean, I'm disinclined to acquiesce to your request, means no. So it's a short way of saying that. No,
don't need to do that. All right, so
patients with no seizure disorder resuming their anti-epileptic medication in the ED. Probably because they're not compliant and you want to load it back up again. Do you have to do that IV or orally, or does it make a difference? What's our guideline say about that? Guideline says it's dealer's choice. You're the dealer. So you make a call. It's perfectly fine to go on oral load. Or an IV load if you're that concerned. Doesn't make any difference. Realize that a lot of the oral loads are going to take a few hours longer. If you're doing, for example, a Dilantin load, it's going to take 5 hours before they actually reach therapeutic levels. For it's in the system. Give it faster, but it's not going to give the system a huge amount of difference. But if you're watching it anyway, an oral load's a whole lot cheaper than an IV load. So this question is, you know, is it about getting it out of here fast or well, I have to watch it a little longer and just go ahead and take a load and metabolize whatever else might be in their system that's concerning. Okay, so breakthrough seizures. Big thing here is, why did it happen? Maybe it's non-compliance. Maybe they've changed their dietary patterns. Maybe they just haven't taken their medicines, of course. Maybe they've got an illness that's lowered their seizure threshold. So history, physical examination, basic stuff. And maybe they're taking too much of the medicine. You know, if you're dying of toxic, you can induce seizures that way. Most anything in gigantic amounts becomes toxic and can induce seizures. Maybe not benzos. All right, so common triggers, they're there. I'm going to read the slides to you. And since you have access to the slides, you can do this later on. I don't know if there's a whole lot of surprises there, but you need to be, you just have to think through methodically. Heard that this morning earlier. Think things through methodically, as long as you approach it with kind of a plan in mind, you know, clue through the different options, you'll be fine. Keep thinking about other things, cardiovascular disorders, maybe stroke, maybe cardiovascular things, syncope, if you get clonus, a little seizure disorder at all. You know, the bicep will tell you those steps, so ask a little more, so, oh, I was in chest pain, I got a short breath, I got a headache, and then I X out. Sound of a seizure. Okay. But it's not a stroke. Okay. But still someone said, well, I saw him twitching, you know, falling out the mouth, and their eyes rolled back in their head. Right. Brain tumors, CNS infection, traumatic injury. Okay.
They fell and then they seized on the floor.
Okay. Reasons for seizures,
long list.
You can find it, pick that up in any textbook. Just realize the differential is long. Just ask lots of probing questions. Okay, don't just blow it off real quick with one or two questions. Ask a little more. Dig a little deeper and see what's going on. And I'm sure all of you have encountered when you ask your patients about substance abuse, then maybe you're reluctant to tell you right off the bat. So you have to gain a little rapport or ask the questions a little bit. I was a student resident all the time. The patient says they just rarely drink, and then after a few minutes, we talk a little bit. I find out that this is their usual six pack a day plus a pint of liquor daily, and they have extra withdrawal seizure. There's no to tell the other person, so take your time, just be relaxed. Other things, seizures obviously are differential syncope, pseudo seizures, psychogenic seizures. Some tips there that are running across. Is the patient who's doing this kind of stuff, is there seizure activity? Or with some pelvic thrusters, it's kind of air pumping. If they're doing that kind of nonsense. And alternate movements with their extremities, upper extremities, they should be synchronized, not alternating. Okay? They're doing yes. It's a faking, not a real shaking. Okay? So, and I just like this. Blame it on the side effects. So it could be some kind of movement disorder that's being mistaken as a seizure. So medications, you're gonna look this up because there's no way you're gonna learn this from lecture. This is out of the guidelines, so you can download those. They're online, PDF file, no big deal. There's all that. Here's the dose. Here's the side effects. Here's what you need to be aware of. What you gotta watch out for. It's all there. Okay. It's here in the slide deck too, but you're not going to always have access to my slide deck.
If you are supplementing or reloading old people, go gently, because a lot of times therapeutic levels are easily achieved at much lower doses. So they don't have that bicep, and I found that picture. All toothless, pissed off look, crooked back, liver spots, hands pulled way down, as opposed to walking around the way down low. Didn't have to go here. So
start low, go slow.
Be gentle on the elbow. So status. It makes knees a little buckle a little bit.
That's the person seizing, they won't quit. And now we have to give higher escalated doses of benzos.
Like, I quit breathing. Okay, so ABCs. Think again, differential. Why might this person be having seizures? Why are they seeing like they're trying to slip away here into status? So maybe it's they just got started on a TB drug.
They've been overdoing it on the INH, trying to catch up. I missed my last 4 days, so I better take 4 days worth right now.
Problem. Claims to cocaine, B6 deficiency that goes with the INH, toxic ingestion, tricyclics, sulfonylureas. Blood sugar is going to be an issue here because as they're busy doing their season, they're going to have great metabolic demands and their glucose can sink. Just because you checked it 5 minutes ago doesn't mean that it's still good right now. It may have fallen significantly. So you may have started this battle fighting over here, but in the meantime, something else has snuck up in the flank.
And that may be hypoglycemia. So keep checking the sugar regularly.
So your first treatments are benzos. Okay. Valium and Ativan. I'm kind of an Ativan person, not so much that. The Valium is fat soluble, so while I'm busy giving it, you have to realize that it's been redistributed in 2 hours, it's going to be used up into the lipid soluble moieties of your body, fat stores. So it's going to, your circulating level is going to drop. Whereas Ativan is going to stay in place a little bit longer, simply being metabolized. The other is actually being moved around into different body compartments. Okay, so what's our policy say? What do we do next? Okay, generalized convulsive status of left PC continue to have seizures. We've optimized the benzos, we've hammered them, they're not budging, they're just not responding to it at all. What do we do next? Okay, well, as they fail, we go on and
next lines are phenytoin, phosphenytoin,
or valproate. No.
Phenytoin, you've got rate limiting factors as far as how fast you can give it. It can cause some pretty significant hypotension. Phosphenytoin, you can get a little trouble with that as well. Valproate is actually suggesting one of the things that I've been reading. Maybe it should be the first and second line drug.
Over Diane.
Yeah. It may be an availability thing. What have you got? What do you have that's available? He's going to say, oh, I'm just talking about Valproate.
Our third line, by the guidelines, is moving on to Keppra, propofol, or barbiturates.
And as you read stuff, you're going to see that different folks are doing things a little differently. Some folks have suspension of phosphenytoin and valproate. Some folks are using the Keppra as their second line drug. You know, the benzos.
Keppra has a pretty good safety profile. Seems to be a pretty good drug.
Does that mean it's our guideline second line? No, it's not. Does it mean it's bad? No. Does it work? Seems to be pretty gosh darn good. Is it safer than these other medicines? Seems to be. So maybe that you consider that as your next line indication.
Okay.
But realize that that's going to be off script a little bit. So when you're doing that, you document your chart. If you don't have valproic acid available, concerned about hypertension, and there's already borderline, kind of holding his pressure patient. So you're using loading patient with Keppra instead. Perfectly good documentation. Good line of thought.
Okay.
Should be perfectly good. Because we're going to throw into our third line medications anyway. Even though it wasn't in that guideline, a lot of folks are using it. They aren't using the second line, they're using it as third line. Because then we start getting into the really high dose benzos, because you're going to cause respiratory depression now. It's, you don't want to be intubating this patient and doing a major blood pressure juggling. You're having sedation, but having to put pressors on and keep pressure up. That's going to be your first aid or your high dose propofol. And this is our kind of procedural deficit. Right? You're going to continue hammering away with that. And your next line is going to be the barbiturates, which, how many of you have ever had experience with barbiturates?
Yeah.
Okay. One person. Okay. I don't. I've never had to go that far. Just a matter of if things, it's just when. So my day's coming. Okay. And another option is gas anesthesia. Of course, for that, you have to have an operating room. But basically, by flooding the cells and
inhibiting the ability to transmit neural symptoms,
signals,
gas anesthesia is an option.
This heavy sedation stuff is going to require that your patient be not only monitored, but you have to have EEG because you can't do any kind of clinical exam. Because if they already moved on to the non-convulsive state anyway, you're still seizing. You know, we'll check that up as an EEG. So it's going to require higher level of care to transfer that patient.
Okay. Don't say it's going to be easy. Okay. But it's going to be problemsome.
And I guess as the speaker earlier, smoking a cigarette back in the back corner is going to kind of keep
your nerves calm a little bit.
Okay. I came in on one case, on shift patient who was in status. Is this even on our? Ivory towers. The ER doctor's trying to do the right thing. Called the operating room, spoke to the anesthesia, and said, that's all great. Well, room clear for him, we'll be ready for a minute. By the way, who's going to be monitoring the EEG? I'm calling neurology right now. Neurology, I work well with my neurology department, but they kind of fumbled on this one, and then they couldn't detect, come down with a machine, and then it was finally, the whole thing's kind of fell in water, and the patient would go to the ICU, there's kind of on drips, and using clinical exam as best they could. It was not the warm fuzzy feeling that everyone was hoping for, just in the ER.
Check the sugar. How many of you all been burned by hypoglycemia?
I raised a couple arms, three or four arms.
Okay.
Yeah. You always shake your head, you're like, dang it, I knew better. And I still got me in the butt by it. I knew better. Okay.
Keep in mind other things,
simple things, thiamine, magnesium for the patient.
If you do manage to get the INH history with a chronic alcoholism, maybe the
paralysis. Another table format, basically the same thing I just presented to you. This particular form, particular table, even though we said the Keppra is not part of the scan. Here we go. as long as you're kind of thinking, like, what are my options? There's lots of options.
You can enjoy that at your leisure. I'm actually on a Simpson Sam, but that was still kind of fun.
By the way, when looking at a list of medications here for the focal seizure versus the generalized or focal seizure, here's our picture. Here's our barbiturate. Here's our valproate. That's why kind of why those are selected and preferred, because you can, whichever kind of seizure it is, you're going to nail those drugs.
Phenytoin.
So you're going to nail this. Interestingly.
Some last things.
ASAP does not answer all the questions, which we kind of like to know the answers for.
How long do I watch a patient in the ER after it resolves their seizure? I feel like they should be able to go home, but how long do I have to watch them?
No, I have an answer to that. At least until the normal, you're happy and comfortable, and family's comfortable with them.
What are those problems obtaining follow-up?
They never happen, right? Do the best you can. I don't have an answer to that. I think the best. What are non-compliant patients? Folks that can't afford them or just refuse to take them? Continues to be a problem. I don't have an answer to that. What are the rules for discharging the home? Right. Driving, engaging in dangerous activities, occupational risks.
And are you going to be liable if they have an accident?
Well, I thought that was kind of interesting. In Georgia, patients who continue to drive vehicles up to but not over 26,000 pounds, I'm not going to go to a car, a typical car is supposed to be around 2 tons, I guess it's about 4,000 pounds, so this is a pretty good size truck. And they have to have been seizure-free for 6 months. Unless they're nocturnal seizures, then the restrictions can be lessened. I'm not quite sure how that works. I guess it's okay as long as they don't fall asleep at the wheel and then have a seizure. Let's think about that for a second. It's supposed to be fine. Okay. For commercial vehicles, basically, you have a seizure disorder, you're pretty much off the list. And vehicles carrying 16 or more persons are considered commercial vehicles. So if they have a seizure disorder, not happening.
Okay.
Can you be sued for reporting the patient?
No, because you're trying to do a good thing.
Are you required to report the patient in Georgia?
No, there's no reporting requirement.
Okay. If you do report them, well then that's fine, but they can't come around and sue you for reporting them because you're still doing good things for society.
Yeah. What's the practice trying to achieve when we do that? Okay. So, a seizure-free interval of 3 to 12 months decreases motor vehicle accidents related to the seizure by 50-80%. So, it's not a bad thing.
Except for the person who's got a seizure, because they're kind of nailed down. In Georgia, like I said, it's only 6 months. And for those of you visiting, there was one person from Texas, I know, or folks from up in Florida. So, find out what the rules are in your state. It doesn't take long. You can go to the Epilepsy Foundation because they have all this stuff compiled for you. So you have to go on a massive internet search. For some patients, it may be a physician note that says that the person's clear for driving or medical review. Okay, reviews that. And they may require periodic submission of records to demonstrate that you've been seizure-free during all of this. Document it when you tell your patient. You know, driving, put in discharge instructions, have them sign, you know, they sign that fine. But putting your, I've discussed it with the risks and hazards, and this patient's instructed specifically not to drive for the next 6 months, or not to drive until they've seen the primary provider or the neurologist to be cleared to be allowed to drive again. So, document. And that's my last slide. I don't think anyone talked about football. I think I need to be an athlete and not mention something about football. I'm not a fan, but. No, darling, it's not coincidence. It's not just coincidence that Santa wears black, white, and red.
Go Dawgs.
Thank you very much.